On this strange night that we call good, we're challenged to find goodness, even in the face of evil. May the goodness of Christ's unending love bring us hope that never wavers. May the presence of Christ in our lives bring forth goodness and love in one another. May this time of gathering strengthen our faith in God and our trust in this body of Christ. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing from the hymnal number 292, What Wondrous Love Is This. Hope. And that baby grew, and even as a as a young boy, he amazed everyone in the temple. He understood, he spoke, he asked questions about the Torah. The teachers there were amazed. This boy, he grew in stature, he grew in wisdom. He became a man that did amazing things. He taught with truth, he taught with power. He taught with mercy and compassion and justice for all. He healed the sick and he healed the lame. This man lived a life of love. He lived a life of love, proclaiming the kingdom of God had arrived on earth. But we also know this man was much more than any ordinary man. Jesus is both divine and human. Jesus comes in the name of the Lord, and this man comes to grant us peace. His final declaration occurred in the days of this week. It began with a meal attended by his closest friends. That night would end in a way that shocked everyone. It shocked them with his death. His death is an atoning sacrifice for our sins. In fact, it's for the sins of the entire world. At the cross is where we leave our mark of sins. Thank you.
Then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." "Where do you want us to prepare for it?" they asked. He replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'Teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you."
As was the custom, Jesus traveled to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. Passover began as a celebration string, a spring, a time of birth, a time of rebirth. It marks the beginning of a harvest season. But we know it's far, far, far no better for the exodus of the chosen people. Those that left after generations of slavery, after they left Egypt. It's a time of celebration, it's a time of journey from slavery to freedom. Jesus and his disciples, they gathered at a table that might look like ours tonight. And it was the first night of the seventh-day Jewish holiday. At this Passover meal, Jesus modeled a new kind of authority for his disciples, and it was called servant leadership. He ministered to the members gathered. Rather than waiting to be served by them, he served. He did what in their cultures, slaves did. He started with the water. Imagine Jesus taking that cloth, putting it over his shoulder, bowing down before the slaves, before the disciples, and pouring that water over their feet. And then he gently took the cloth, and he dried all the water from their feet. The dirt was gone from their long journey. And then came the meal. Our meal that we know represented by bread and by the juice. The meal was bigger, but out of this meal came our institution of the Last Supper, of the Eucharist. We know that Jesus, he took the bread and he broke it, and he said to each of those disciples, he said, "Take, eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." And he also, he took the cup. He said, "This is the cup." We know the words as, "Do this in remembrance of me. This is the blood that was shed for you." Remember these words of this meal. "Do this in remembrance of me." I invite you to stand as we sing from the faith to say, actually, stay seated. And let us sing "In Remembrance of Me," number 2254, that's from Black Smaller Hymnal.
Thank you. Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So, could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, he went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
After the meal was over, they went to the garden. It's not hard for us to imagine the garden. Think of the gardens we see this time of the year with fresh buds, blooming, all this sign of life. This garden, it was a familiar place for Jesus. He had been there many times before to pray. Imagine that garden as where life began. Life began in the garden with Adam. And now, the life of Jesus would be known for this garden, that that was where his life ended. The night he came to this garden, it was to be his last time. It was his last trip to this garden where he was joined by his disciples. There was Peter and James and John. He went to pray one last time. As that night wore on, Jesus found himself alone. He was alone. He was deserted. He was vulnerable. It was then that he decided what had to be done. He would not fight. He wouldn't run. He wouldn't even bargain for his life. And then he prayed to God and he said, "Oh God, take this cup away from me. Yet not my will, but yours. Yet not my will, but yours." For Jesus knew that soon, very soon, his betrayer would be arriving. And he would bring with him those that were seeking his death on the cross. On this night in this beautiful garden, the shadow of the cross, it loomed over the garden and it loomed over Jesus.
Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I betray him?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment, he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. While Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword and drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place, so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled." And all the disciples deserted him and fled.
The betrayal began before Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. The betrayal began before he broke the bread and shared the cup. The Gospel of John, it writes of Jesus' prediction of betrayal before he even entered Jerusalem triumphantly days before. Judas had already sealed the betrayal. 30 pieces of silver. He had already sealed the deal. In that garden, a large group appeared. When Jesus was still speaking to his disciples, they were led by Judas, who we know was one of the 12. The sign had been given. The time had come for Jesus to be handed over. We know what one of his followers did. He picked up that sword, and he knew that blood was shared. But Jesus said, "No, that's not the way it's to be done." The time had come for the trial to begin. As Jesus looked back to that garden, where he had had that time with his disciples, it was empty. They had all deserted him. Had all fled, leaving him alone. And from there, he was to stand trial. He was to be beaten. He was to be humiliated. He was to be broken. At that moment, the disciples had made the temptation that Jesus had predicted. They made it.
governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." Then he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified."
Jesus was taken to the house of the high priest. And when he got there, what happened? He was mocked and he was beaten. They asked him questions, but the answers he gave, he would only give a few words. He would give incomplete answers. That lack of response, only giving a few words, that just prompted them more. There were further beatings. There was further slapping. There was further insults. The next day, as Jesus stood before the governor Pilate, he was questioned again. But still, he gave no sufficient answers. But coming to his defense, there was one, and it was Pilate's own wife. The Bible doesn't tell us her name. Other ancient writings, they offer perhaps a name, but we don't even know her name. But she came to his defense. She had the courage to testify about his righteousness, to testify about the innocence of this man that was on trial. Her intervention, it caused her husband to hesitate. But Pilate was more afraid of the crowd. He was afraid of the riot. He saw nothing that he could do but to satisfy the crowd. So the crowd's words became Pilate's command: "Crucify him. Crucify that man." And with those orders, the soldiers of the governor, they took Jesus into Pilate's headquarters. They stripped him, and they put on him a scarlet robe. And then they twisted some thorns to make a crown, and they placed that crown on his head. Even imagine the pain of those thorns as they touched his already tender scalp. And then they made fun of him. They ridiculed him. It said, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spat on him. And they struck him some more. And then they stripped him of that scarlet robe and they put on his own clothes. We can imagine what they would look like. Dirty. Blood. Probably had holes in them by that point. And at that point, Jesus was led away to be crucified. invite you now to stand as we sing in our hymnal number 288. Are you there?
One of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. The others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs. He entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, "Truly, this man was God's son."
We've journeyed far from the triumphal entry that we saw on Sunday. We've traveled past the foot washing that showed us a new way of serving. We've shared in the Passover meal and how Holy Communion came to be from that meal. We walked with Jesus. We walked to the garden and we witnessed what had to be done. So tonight, we find ourselves on the saddest night of the church. We, like the disciples and the followers, we might find ourselves feeling alone. We might find ourselves feeling fearful. Jesus has been through the legal system of Rome. He was accused, he was jailed, he was judged. And now, he's been executed. The hope in this one, who many saw as the Messiah, the one who would lift that heavy yoke that Rome had placed upon the people, this one had been taken away. And the question was, and the question is on this night, why did Jesus die on the cross? Some say it was because he offended those that were in power. Some say he ended up on that cross because he challenged the status quo. Some say he died on that cross because he wouldn't sit silently by when there were those that were being stepped on, those that were being used and abused by those that had so much to offer. But most would say that Jesus died on a cross to pay for our sins. Scripture and the early church writings point to Jesus' death as being related to the sins of humanity, our sins. When we act in unloving ways, we distance ourselves from God, and that is sin. Sin is that action that separates us from God. As we reflect on our lives and our sin, we have to explore our actions within our family, within our neighborhood, our community. We have to look at our actions in the world. Do our actions separate us from God? Our actions, do they come from a place of love or somewhere else? These questions, they bring us back to the commandment that Jesus offered, that's written in the Gospel of John. "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." Jesus knew what he was doing. He knew where his actions were going to lead him. Three times he predicted that his death would be by crucifixion. Yet he continued on. It's written, he believed through love the The actions that led Jesus to be crucified, the actions that he took, they were actions of love for us. So tonight, we come to the cross. When we look at that cross, it's empty of his body. They've crucified our Lord, and they've taken him away, and they put him in a cave. And then they rolled a stone in front of it so big that no one could move it. But yet, when you look at this cross, it will never, ever be empty. That cross up there, it is filled with our sins. It's also filled with God's love. And that love is overflowing out of that cross. Tonight, we'll symbolically place our sins on this cross. We have paint, and it represents our actions. It represents those actions that distance ourselves from God. This paint and these marks, they represent the actions that distance and separate us from God. So in a minute, when you're ready, I invite you, while Kevin's playing some music, to privately come up and offer your sins to God by making a mark on that canvas. Almighty God, I ask for forgiveness for the times when I have not listened to you and I have not done your will. You may whisper that, you may just say it in your mind, but know that God answers you if you are forgiven. The death of Jesus on the cross, it shows us how far God's love will go. It shows us that God's love, through the death of his only son on the cross, his only son Jesus Christ, it saved us from our sins. I invite you, as you are ready, to come up and make a mark on the cross.